types in the world, behind only T-Series. T-Series is a Bollywood channel on YouTube. So number two of all channels, number one in sports. People ask me all the time, and I heard kind of somebody chuckle when I talked about our success in India. They're like, so I don't get it, you know, because this is so American, this product. How could 75% of the content be consumed outside the U.S.? And I always tell them, and if they were an investor, most of them didn't take any English classes in college, so they took a lot of math. So I always tell them, if you go back and take a literature course, you'll read about Joseph Campbell. Joseph Campbell wrote The Monomyth or The Hero's Journey about 50 years ago, and he was an academic. And he said, if you look across every culture in the world, the storytelling archetype is the same. And he called it the monomyth, the hero's journey. A hero emerges. A hero has a dilemma. A mentor emerges to help the hero overcome. Dark forces align against the hero. So I'm screwing it up. It's been 30 years since I took the course. But if you buy the monomyth of the hero's journey, you see it and you go, holy cow. John Cena is going through a hero's journey, like Katniss Everdeen is going through the hero's journey, like Luke Skywalker is going through the hero's journey. The difference is it's not intergalactic warfare. It's not a dystopian future. It's what's the other benefit for us. Our context is a ring. One of the simplest things to understand around the world. Whether you're in Mexico, the Middle East, in India, Pakistan, UK, US, you see a ring and you see people going into the ring, you know what's going to happen. You know what is going to happen. And it's important because look, I'm a huge NFL fan. Why does the NFL struggle in India? Because nobody understands the game. I mean, it's hard to watch the NFL. I've been watching the NFL with my three daughters for, 18 years and 13 years with my twins. They don't really understand the NFL game that much. They kind of understand basketball. They get soccer, free-flowing sport. The NFL's tough to understand. And it's similar. Why is cricket not made it in the U.S.? Cricket's another game that's pretty difficult to understand. So we've got the commonality of the hero's journey, that storytelling element. And then we're lucky. It's a ring. It's easy to understand. So that's why the WWE content plays around the world. And we've been doing it for a long time. It's now going on 40 years, 35 years since Vince bought the company from his father. And so whether it's Bruno Sammartino, then to Andre the Giant, then to Stone Cold Steve Austin, then to The Rock, and then to Charlotte, who was our women's champion, we've been able to create this pipeline of great talent to keep the story alive generation after generation. So next topic I want to touch on is this transformation that Jason managed. And if you look at the history of the company, Vince bought it. If I went back before 99, bought it. It was a Northeast touring company, just selling tickets. The next version of the business was 1999 to 2010. So it's a media model, media business. He turned it from a ticketing business to a media business, 360 degrees. Then 11 for 14 is where it was the pivot that Jason mentioned. He said, boy, I was really, I admire what the team has done, that pivot. I will tell you, during that time frame, we were getting no admiration. Nobody understood why social was important. Nobody understood why we would launch our own direct-to-consumer network and cannibalize a very profitable business. But all of that is what's led to the company as it sits here today, this new model that we're in the early days of. I mean, it really was starting in early 15 that you started seeing the manifestation of that work in 11 to 14. And just a couple of examples of the change. In 2010, about $478 million in revenue, 10% of the revenue was coming on a digital channel, whether it was selling a product on a digital channel, selling advertising, or a subscription. Trailing 12 months, now 60% revenue growth, and over a third, roughly, is on a digital channel. The biggest part of that, the direct-to-consumer business. And then similar, there's an overlap here between digital and direct-to-consumer, but it's not a perfect. It's not one-to-one. In 2010, about a quarter of our revenues were direct-to-consumer, where we would actually interact with the consumer in some way, as opposed to going through a third party. Like a license, when I sell a toy, I'm going through Mattel. That's a third party. When somebody watches Raw and SmackDown, I've licensed that content to a network. I'll talk about that. It's a third party. Now we sell product directly. We deliver video directly. So today, about half the business is direct-to-consumer, which underpins a lot of our data strategy, and I'll talk about that in a little bit as well. But that is the manifestation of the change we're talking about. I talked about the 1,500 hours we create, and I was going to say, if you're going to understand anything and invest in WWE, I think you should understand this, because your perspective on this is going to inform whether you think it's something you want to be part of the ride on or not. So those 1,500 hours that we create, the biggest decision we make today that was not a decision we had to make 8 or 9 years ago because these other platforms didn't exist, is where do we put these hours? What are we trying to accomplish with the content we're creating? New fans, female fans, kids, engaged current fans, super serve our hardcore fans. So there's a variety of things we're trying to accomplish. Where to put it? The three places we do it, pay TV. So today, our most valuable content in terms of engagement and monetization sits in the pay TV bundle. We create 5 hours of live event content, Monday nights and Tuesday nights, in an arena around the world. 260 hours of original live content a year, and we license that into the pay TV ecosystem. NBCU in the US, Rogers in Canada, BSkyB in the UK, Sony in India, Fox in Latin America, OSN in the Middle East. That's where our most valuable content sits. And remember, of that 5 to 6 billion hours of consumption, about 75-80% of it is still Raw and SmackDown, because it's our most valuable content. Second area, I mentioned we're now up to 550 million hours consumed, primarily on YouTube, Facebook growing quite a bit, but primarily on YouTube. We've created 42,000 short-form pieces of content, had over 18 billion video views across all platforms over the last 12 months, 1.2 billion social media engagements, 825 million. So what's on that? Short-form clips of the long-form, as well as unique content that we create just for those platforms. We just announced today with Next VR that we're doing 6 shows in 2018, about 10 minutes each on their platform, available on all the on the various headsets. That's an example. We just announced a exclusive live show with Facebook, Mixed Match Challenge. Right? So we're doing exclusive shows on these platforms for certain reasons, to go deeper. The next generation of fans, we know they're coming on these platforms. Obviously, I've got 3 kids, 3 girls. They haven't turned the cable box on in a long time. When they go watch video, it's either Chromecast, Apple TV, and it's either YouTube for lean forward or Netflix and Hulu for lean back. That's what goes there. And then finally, our direct-to-consumer network. It's now the number 2 branded SVOD service in the world. So not an aggregator like Netflix or Hulu, they're aggregating. We're branded, single brand. So the largest is baseball. WWE is the second largest, 1.5 million subscribers paying $10 a month. So this product is for a small sliver of our fan base. You're getting Raw and SmackDown on pay TV. You're experiencing it and a bunch of other type of content we're creating on YouTube and Facebook. If you're a super WWE fan, you get our playoffs. Our Super Bowl is there, WrestleMania. You get new content we create. We've done reality series, animated series using our IP. And then you have the long tail. You now have a 10,000-hour video archive growing every day where you can experience every piece of content WWE's ever released, including every Raw and SmackDown that's ever been done. Eventually makes its way onto the network. So to super serve our most passionate fans, that's what we do with WWE Network. So now as we look to the future, there are some key trends. If you're involved in media, we're all aware of it. Live content is becoming even more valuable within the bundle because it's the reason that people still want the bundle. Direct-to-consumer is becoming a bigger and bigger habit. People are getting every day get a little bit more comfortable going direct to consumer, whether it's for software, for video, for music. The next generation is finding its way to engage with brands on the social and digital platforms. We see that. We think that accelerates in a country like India as the next billion users come on primarily on mobile. Broadband every day gets a little bit stronger, more bandwidth, as well as the penetration grows. Social platforms have become a video destination. Obviously, YouTube is created that world. Facebook wants to fast follow. And then the growth of the middle class and emerging markets. For us specifically, our popularity in India and what's happening macroeconomically in India is a real opportunity, we think. So we've got these core businesses that are doing very well today, and we think the key growth drivers are continue to drive monetization of our premium content, close the monetization engagement gap internationally. Remember, 25% of our revenues come from outside the US, but 75% of our video engagement. That's where that growing middle class, we think, makes a difference over time. And then continue to utilize data to drive this 360-degree business model in a very different way. People have talked to us, what's the scale of the fan base? We've done primary research in our top 16 markets, about 311 million broadband homes. About half of them have someone in the home with some WWE affinity. And obviously there's an avidity scale among this 160 million. There's hardcore, aspirational hardcore, light casual, a fan parent, a lapsed fan. So there's an avidity there. But the point being, there's scale to the brand. I talked about our direct-to-consumer network. We launched in 14. It's amazing to me sitting here today that we're coming up on the four-year anniversary. It has been a blur. And as I mentioned, about 1.5 million subscribers paying $10 a month, about 25% of those subs outside the U.S. It's a U.S. product. Should have mentioned that before, right? It's English language, U.S. dollar currency. We haven't localized it yet. We made it available around the world. So we've got 25% of our subs are coming from outside the U.S. We think the opportunity to grow bigger internationally with the network is actually to localize the product, which is something that's on our roadmap. I mentioned our top seven agreements, licensing of Raw and SmackDown, primarily Raw and SmackDown. The last time we went through this renewal cycle, in the last year of the old agreements, we were at about 130 million. We renegotiated them. Here's our top seven. In 2015, you saw a step up of about 30%. And then you've seen about 10% escalators on average across the basket of the seven. So it's been a big driver in the revenue and profit growth over the last 3 years for WWE. As we look to the future, we said we have these deals. We have several deals expiring starting Jan 1/19 through early 2020. In fact, most of our content agreements will expire during that time frame, and so therefore we have the opportunity to renew or go direct to consumer, decide what the distribution strategy is in these markets. The U.S., which is the largest content deal we have, expires in Q3 of 2019. We've said, given the way the contract is structured, that we believe we'll make an announcement sometime between May and September of this year. We tell people that's our best educated guess on the timing. It could be before, it could be after, but based on our the way the contract is structured, our best estimate is May to September. UK and India are our second and third largest deals, similar in size. The UK deal expires at the end of 19. We think we'll announce our distribution strategy in the UK in the second half of 18. And then finally, India also expires at the end of 19. We think we'll announce our distribution strategy in India for Raw and SmackDown in the first half of 19. So obviously you need to have a perspective on what you think the value of live content is around the world, these three markets especially, and WWE's performance in those markets. And as I tell people, all that data is public, so you can go access it yourself, see how we're doing, see how competitors are doing, and come to a perspective on the value of Raw and SmackDown. The other growth driver, as I mentioned, international has been a great success story. It's grown at about a 9% CAGR for 13 years, so the business has tripled since 2004. That mismatch on the 75% engagement, 25% monetization, we think that's a long tailwind for us. Some of it under our control, things like localizing more of our content, whether it's direct to consumer or social and digital, more languages, for example. So it's in our control. We also think there's just some exogenous factors, some tailwinds, macroeconomic tailwinds in developing markets that as long as we do the hard work of continuing to engage fans, should be to our benefit. Now I'm going to pivot to data at WWE. Roughly, we have about 10 million user accounts that we've been focused on creating over the last 7 years or so. And for all these companies, and you folks are talking to other companies who are making this direct-to-consumer pivot, should be one of the questions you ask is, how many user accounts have you got? Because a lot of folks are really starting from zero almost, even large companies. So what do we know about these 10 million? Well, it depends. We don't know everything about all 10 million, but in the aggregate, I've got about 400 different ways I look at consumption on our direct-to-consumer network. What genre, what device. Past payment behaviors. Are you more comfortable with credit card, debit card? When do you pay? How are you interacting when we communicate with you through emails or push notifications? Demographics, credit, lifestyle data. We're able to overlay third-party data against our own data to understand at the consumer level, at the person level. What platforms do you use? What screen sizes? You visit an event. What ticket price did you pay? Where did you sit? What products are you buying directly from us? So what does that do? Well, let's take an example. We've got thousands of variables. In this particular case, favorite network star is AJ Styles. You've made 6 payments on the network. You've purchased 4 tickets in the last year. You've, on our website, you've had 100 sessions, and you've bought 30 items to date. You will get messaging personalized to what you've bought and who your favorite stars are. You bought those 4 tickets, average price of $150. Well, did you know that as a network subscriber, this is what you get? So tailored to your behavior on WWE Network and through our ticketing platform. 38 items purchased to date. We know you're a high LTV customer. Well, you'll give a special promotion just for you. Helps us think about what content to create. One of the things that shocked even us when we launched the network is how much in-ring content people were watching. They already have 5 hours live of Raw and SmackDown every week. Well, those hardcore fans wanted more live. So you've seen the UK Championship. We've never done that before. It's a local championship, non-WWE talent that we've produced in the UK. Did great on the network. The Mae Young Classic, similar. Find the next batch of female WWE stars. We created a series on the network, 205 Live, for cruiserweights, under 205-pound athletes. Very different than what you would see on Raw and SmackDown. When we launched NXT and moved it from just being a development brand to a touring brand, we used the viewership data in the United States that we had on the network, people who were watching NXT, to figure out how should we start touring NXT. A lot of what we just saw 5, 6, 7, 8 years ago, on the marketing side, everyone would have gotten one message. On the decision-making side, it would have been instinct and intuition of smart people. Fundamentally, the ability to capture and act on data is fundamentally transforming WWE from the inside out. So we are doing those things that I just mentioned. What we can't do yet is do all of that at scale, on an automated basis across every single account. That's what we're continuing to build out. You know, so it's a 2-year roadmap or so. It started out as a 5-year, about 3 years in. And I always say it's conceptually not difficult to do, but it's laborious. So it's time and effort. So when you hear management talk about investing in content, in global footprint, in our global operations, and in data and technology, that data and technology, it's that. Then on the financial outlook, if you look over the last 3 years, including trailing 12 months, you've seen steady revenue growth, you've been operating income growth, and adjusted OIBDA growth. If you want to understand the business model, you have this solid base of predictable revenue, our live event business, our consumer products business. You have what we believe are the high growth revenue streams I talked about, live content, delivered pay TV bundle, we think, or bundled by someone else, but delivered through a partnership, our direct-to-consumer, our AVOD. It's a high variable margin business, So you need to understand the difference between variable margin, gross margin, and operating margin. Sometimes people conflate those things. Unit economics are important. We have very high unit economics. We have high fixed costs, but very high unit economics. And then we said we're going to continue to invest in three things. We're going to create more content. We're going to drive more globalization. That could mean globalizing the content or localizing the content, more people on the ground in these markets. And we're going to continue to invest in data technology. For 2017, we started the year saying we'd expect to achieve record revenues. Trailing 12 months, we're at $784. We'll deliver record revenues. Started the year saying adjusted OIBDA of about $100 million. On the call, we raised that to $108 to $112 million, and we said we'd hit another year of record subscribers. Looking for 2018, we expect another year of record revenues. It'll be our fifth year in a row. Record adjusted OIBDA of $115 million. And people have asked, boy, that's not a lot of growth from 17. It's true on an adjusted basis. It's that investment level. We're going to keep putting in investing back into the business. And then record subscriber levels. So with that, I'll stop. When you say use the same people, you mean in terms of? But what people? I don't understand.
Well, you don't do it all yourself. You use some type of technology.
Yeah, got it. Yep.
Some type of provider. Is anybody better than another?
No, we haven't changed it. So for the actual infrastructure has been built on AWS. We do some things on Azure and Google Cloud, but on the data engineering side, primarily AWS, and we have external support on that. A company called Cognizant supports that effort on the data engineering side. On the data analytics side, so not the building of the technology, but the usage of the data and the promulgating of the data internally, we have an internal team. It was probably five people, you know, 6-7 years ago. It's 40 today, half of it onshore, WWFTs, about half of it offshore. And we use EXL kind of as a BPO model for the DA side, but it's significantly larger than it was. And on the, you know, I always say on the infrastructure side, what, you know, whether it's Amazon, Google, Microsoft, on the tool side, they're all good. And so there are trade-offs that you have to make, but we find them, there's a lot of choice for us.
Your pricing on that,
how's that? Look, I mean, Amazon is fairly vocal, and if you're a customer, you know that, on their ability to drive price down. So on a per unit basis, the price has been the pricing has been to our benefit. Obviously, we use and create a lot more data today, but yeah, cost has not been an issue there, other than the cost that we have to invest in people because we want to go faster. We want to get to what I said faster, which is the debate we have internally. Yeah, absolutely. And I always say the network, a couple of things. It's our second largest business, our second most profitable business, has great unit economics. So we have taken what was a secularly declining pay-per-view business, and what you would argue was probably anachronistic or becoming anachronistic, and turned it into kind of one of our jewels, both from a strategic standpoint and financial. So financial, I just mentioned. Strategic, the core of that data universe is WWE Network, because that's where we get the most information about what you like as a fan for our most valuable fans. So it's really, really important strategically. If we're going to continue this direct-to-consumer journey, the network becomes incredibly important. If you said to me, Jason, you know, intermediate term, 2-3 years from now, what makes that number grow? I think it's two things that are on our roadmap. Number one is that localization. I think in 2020, if we're sitting here, the network would probably be available in at least one other language around the world. And people ask, well, you know, what language? I said, look, the leaders in the clubhouse, if you think of WWE, Spanish seems interesting, potentially Hindi. People have speculated about Germany because they assume, and they're correct, that Germany is a great market for us for the network. But I think localization generally. And the second element, which we've talked about, we think there's a unique opportunity to create kind of a super version of the network, you know, and people call it tiering, you know, tiering the network. If you think about all the different ways we are touching our consumers, imagine a day when a network subscriber or a subset of network subscribers can get their tickets before anyone else, can get free shipping on product, things like that. We touch our fans in so many different ways. We think there's a way to create value there for them and for us. So the tiering of the product, both on the upper end, you know, a premium version, if you will, of the network, and potentially even on the lower end, where you create a place that has a little bit less friction in terms of usage to get more people involved, which then creates kind of a natural funnel. It's what Spotify does with their free tier versus their paid tier. So I think intermediate to long term, those are the things that bend the curve. I think between now and then, it's utilizing the data better and better to drive both acquisition and retention. But yeah, I mean, I always tell people, just to be clear, regardless of what the sub growth is in a particular quarter, our perspective, you know, so just so you know what our internal perspective is, this has been an incredible success, and it's the underpinning for of where we think the world is going over the next 10 years or so.
And am I right, the $9.99 price point that you have has not changed thus far?
That's right. It would be a first, that's right. And which is, you know, people have asked, I've been getting questions about this topic almost since we launched. And one of the things that we've said all along is you have to be careful on doing what we just talked about, trying to segment the demand curve. If you make a mistake, you risk doing significant damage to the business. So we've been thoughtful. Some people think we've been overly thoughtful. There are people who have said, you guys are taking too long. I get it. You know, we're the ones closest to it. We've decided to play it very slow.
Yep.
That's right. Yeah, so the product today doesn't work in India for a couple of reasons. Yeah, so the question was, well, obviously international is a way to accelerate this, because in a country like India, a $9.99 price point won't work. Actually, the product in India doesn't work for a variety of reasons. The price point, it's only available in English. And if you look at our rights, we actually today license the pay-per-views, which is a big part of the value proposition of the network, to our pay TV partner, Sony. So even from a value proposition perspective, it doesn't work. It's available there. People want the great on-demand capabilities. You can do it, but it's not a product tailored there. But that's why I mentioned to Jason, I think when you look out 2-3 years from now, if we're able to accelerate the growth, I think doing something like what you just said, localizing the product, it could be a big part of that. It is difficult, and I don't think I'm going to tell you anything that you probably haven't thought of already. I mean, what we do is we just survey the marketplace, and we look at all types of content. We looked at scripted content, we look at live content or content that's creating live viewership, and then we say, well, what are people paying for that? And then do some math around that and say, all right, well, that's at least an indicator of what you think you're worth. Now, I will tell you, having done that math historically, the fact of the matter is Raw and SmackDown in the United States, has been undervalued relative to that type of analysis. There's no doubt about it. I mean, people always ask, when people ask about WWE, you know, we don't have a valuation problem. We certainly don't have a brand problem. We have a monetization problem. You know, we have not monetized the brand, especially Raw and SmackDown in the United States, relative to its performance. And you could argue, well, why is that? And people, you know, and there's a bunch of theories. They're all unprovable. So I think all I could tell you is that's the math that we do to try to get a sense of when we sit down with folks so we can communicate what we think the value is. Ultimately, the value is going to be determined by the marketplace, how much interest there is, how much competitive juices there are, and that whether people see the content through the same lens we do. I will tell you, from a pay TV perspective, and this is, again, really important, the things that drive these big economics to content or rights owners is if you believe the content, it drives distribution. If it's only ad-supported, no piece of content makes a lot of money. The ones that get paid is because the buyer says, that piece of content, given its scale of viewership and where it positions me in the leader tables, helps me drive affiliate fees up, helps me today stay in the bundle, which was not a risk before. That's what you've got to, so you got to have a perspective, is WWE that type of content or not? Yeah, I remember being at CES, it's probably 2012 or so, and people were talking about OTT distribution, you know, and it was still early, and, you know, a couple of small little channels and doing, but there was nothing really at scale. And I remember myself and Michelle and one of my colleagues out here talking about, because we were already thinking about the network, and we were gathering intelligence of what we would do if and when the time came for us. I think VR and AR we're in the same place as, you know, OTT in 2011, which is some form of it is coming, and we're in that experimentation stage. And the partnership we announced with Next VR today, we think is, you know, I've seen it. I did a little interview on Cheddar today. You know, I've seen the content. It's amazing. I mean, if you are a fan of WWE, to put that on and find yourself in the content, it is amazing. So I use Google Daydream View. I think it's $99, well worth the investment. And when next we are, when our shows come out, I would say get it. It's really amazing. But that's where we are. We're experimenting, because 5 years from now, my guess is probably on our network, you'll see some element of that. Yeah, I mean, we've done VR. We did something with Samsung back at SummerSlam a couple of years ago. Everybody does it, loves it. I think it's the ubiquity of the usage. You know, it's growing, but it's still relatively small. But if you put it on and do it, you think it's amazing. And the same thing on AR, which probably internally we're more interested in. We think that has some unique applications. But again, you'll probably hear us announce something within the next 12 months on AR as well. We're in that experimentation stage. But it's all about engaging our super fans, right? I mean, that really ultimately is what it is.
That's fantastic. Thank you very much.
Great. Thanks for having us.